cora nostra, quesumus domine, due miserationis operation, via divisini te placere, non possumus, per nam rosum, iesum Christum filium tuum, vidi tecum in regna, trinitatis unitus sancti Deus, per omnia secula seculorum.
Amen.
Ex officii beati, alia vostri, honore mio. Padres, gratias ago Deo meo, semper pro vobis in gratia Dei. Quidabdes vobis in Christo Iesu, coronibus ides, patria visinilo, in omni verbo, et in omni sentientia, sicut est molium Christi confirmatum est in vobis, ida tico vobis tensit in una gratia, expectantibus revelationum Domini nostri Iesu Christi, quia confirmavi, vos usque in finem est fine crimine in die, in die adventus Domini nostri Iesu Christi. Cogitatis male cordibus vestri. Quid est facilius dicere, dimittum tur tibi peccata tua andicere, surge et ambula, surge et ambula. Quid autem sciatis, quia filius omnis habe potestatem in terra, dimittendi peccata, nunc ait paralytico, surge troledectum tuum et vari et domum tuam. Insurrexit David in domum suam. Quidem est autem turbe timuerunt, equivica verunt Deum, quid erit potestatem talem hominibus. Thank you. thing, to be down, we'll have the immediately after Mass, and go down for the, into the garage down there for the food and so on. And so we'll have a little picnic thing after Mass, to which all are invited. Also pray for the seminarians. We're actually finished our, we had two retreats this last week, last 2 weeks. We had 17 women on the retreat 2 weeks ago and 27 men on the retreat last week, including also the seminarians. And future seminarians, we have 14 or 15 altogether. You know, and of course it's going to, you know, things go up and down, but pray for the young men that are coming also, for particularly for an Indian who's should be here now, but he has paperwork and that has to be taken care of, and should have been taken care of by now, but it was delayed. And so hopefully the next few weeks we'll be able to be here. And then also to keep the seminarians and brothers in your prayers, need vocations. And then also all of the missions of the apostolate. And then in any case, after the Mass today will be a the epistle for the 18th Sunday after Pentecost is taken from St. Paul's letter, first letter to Corinthians, chapter 1. I give thanks to my God always concerning you for the grace of God which was given you in Christ Jesus, because in everything you have been enriched in him, in all utterance and all knowledge, even as the witness to Christ has been made so firm in you that you lack no grace, while awaiting the appearance of our Lord Jesus Christ, who will also keep you secure unto the end, unimpeachable in the day of the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the Gospel. In that quote, to sing Matthew chapter 9. At that time, Jesus, getting into a boat, crossed over and came into his own town. And behold, they brought to him a paralytic lying on a pallet. Jesus, seeing their faith, said to the paralytic, "Take courage, son, thy sins are forgiven thee." And behold, some of the scribes said within themselves, "This man blasphemes." And Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, "Why do you harbor evil thoughts in your hearts? Which is easier, to say, 'Thy sins are forgiven thee,' or to say, 'Arise and walk'? But that you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins." Then he said to the paralytic, "Rise, take up thy pallet, and go to thy house." And he arose and went away to his house. But when the crowd saw it, they were struck with fear, glorifying God who had given such power to men. That's why the words of today's Holy God. Today is the 18th Sunday after Pentecost. Also this second Sunday of October, and we'll read here also from the scripture, so I'll just read a few passages here and then consider putting them together. First, from the scripture, from the scripture reading today in the Holy Breviary, and then from the prophecy of St. Francis and a vision of Anne Kraftman. First of all, the sacred scripture of the Breviary today, which we'll read throughout the whole Bible, throughout the entire liturgical year. Today we read from the book of Maccabees, chapter 4. The day when Judas Maccabeus purified the temple, which was in fact December 25th. The day of the actual purification was December 25th, which is the origin of the Jewish feast of Hanukkah, and our feast of Christmas sometimes matches that day. And the year that Judas purified the temple was the same day that Christ chose to be born, because the calendars are lunar and solar, they don't always match. But then Judas and his brethren said, "Behold, our enemies are discomfited. Let us go up now and cleanse the holy places to repair them." And all the array assembled together, and they went up into the Mount Zion. And they saw the sanctuary desolate, and the altar profaned, and the gates burnt, and the shrubs growing up in the courts, as in a forest or on the mountains, and the chambers joining to the temple thrown down, And they rent their garments and made great lamentation, and put ashes upon their back on their heads. And they fell down to the ground on their faces, and they sounded with trumpets of alarm, and they cried towards heaven. Then Judas appointed men to fight against them that were in the castle till they had been cleansed the holy places. And he chose priests without blemish, whose will was set upon the law of God. And they cleansed the holy places, and took away the stones that had been defiled unto an unclean place. And he considered about the altar of the holocausts that had been profaned, that what he should do with it. And a good counsel came unto their minds to pull it down, lest it should be a reproach unto them, because the Gentiles had defiled it. So they threw it down, and they laid up the stones in the mountains, and on mountains of the temple, and in a convenient place, till there should come a prophet and give them answer concerning them. Then they took whole stones, according to the law, and built a new altar, according to the former. And they built up the holy places, and the things that were within the temple. And they sanctified the temple and the courts. And they made new holy vessels, and brought in the candlestick, and the altar of incense, and the table into the temple. And they put incense upon the altar, and they lighted up the lamps that were upon the candlestick, and they gave light in the temple. And they set the loaves upon the table, and hung up the veils, and finished all the works that they had begun to make. And here this prophecy, this action, not prophecy, but the history of the action of Judas Maccabeus is going to happen very soon in the history of the church. We are now in the times of Judas Maccabeus, and there will be, of the New Testament, and there will be a renewal, and the things that happened that Judas decided to do here, they shall be done again in the New Testament. Now we go to the prophecy of St. Francis of Assisi, which he made shortly before he died, in a book written in 1882. A short time before the Holy Father's death, he called together his children and warned them of the coming trouble, saying, "Act bravely, my brethren. Take courage and trust in the Lord. The time is fast approaching, in which there will be great trials and afflictions, perplexities and dissensions, both spiritual and temporal, will abound. The charity of men will grow cold, and the malice of the wicked will increase. The devils will have unusual power. The immaculate purity of our order, the Franciscans, and of others, will be so much obscured that there will be very few Christians who will obey the true sovereign pontiff of the Roman Church with loyal hearts and perfect charity. At this time of desolation, tribulation, a man not canonically elected will be raised with the pontificate, who by his coming will endeavor to draw many into error and death. Then scandals will be multiplied, our order will be divided, and many others will be entirely destroyed, because they will consent to error instead of opposing it. There will be such diversity of opinions and schisms amongst the people, the religious and the clergy, that except those days were shortened according to the words of the gospel, even the elect would be led into error, were they not specially guided amid such confusion by the immense mercy of God. Then our rule and manner of life will be violently opposed by some, and terrible trials will come upon us. Those who are found faithful will receive the crown of life, but woe to those who, trusting solely in their order, shall fall into tepidity, for they will not be able to support the temptations permitted for the providing for the proving of the elect. Those who preserve their fervor and adhere to virtue and love and zeal for the truth will suffer injuries and persecutions as rebels and schismatics, for their persecutors, urged on by the evil spirits, will say they are rendering a great service to God
by destroying such pestilent men from the face of the earth. But the Lord will be the refuge of the afflicted and will save all those who trust in him. And in order to be their head, these, the elect, will act with confidence and by their death will purchase for themselves eternal life. Choosing to obey God rather than man, they will fear nothing, and they will prefer to perish rather than consent to falsehood and perfidy. Some preachers will keep silence about the truth, and others will trample it underfoot and deny it. The sanctity of life will be held in derision even by those who outwardly profess it. For in those days our Lord Jesus Christ will send them not a true pastor, but a destroyer. In their consideration of St. Francis. And now to a vision of Anne Catherine Emmerich, a dream concerning two popes. In any case, the first part of the dream just described that she saw a pope of the past. A pope of the past who asked the emperor if he could build a temple. And so this emperor asked the emperor if he could purify the temple and make it into a Catholic church. Or rather, the temple then sent word, the emperor sent back word to the pope, and he said, yes, you can make the temple, the pagan temple, into a church, but leave the statues of the pagans there and erect the cross in the middle of the temple and give the cross the highest honor. Let it be known that your God has the highest honor in our temple. And then the request was made, or the suggestion was made to Anne Catherine Emmerich out of ignorance rather than by wickedness of will. And so the Pope therefore was considering what he should do. Should he go ahead and take the temple and put a cross in it? And in the highest place that all might honor the cross and leave the other statues of the gods in the temple? And he wasn't sure what to do. But there was a priest in the church praying in a white robe, and praying before God. And an angel was beside the priest. And as the priest finished his prayer, he rose up, he went straight to the face of the Pope, and he said to the Holy Father, do not listen to this wicked advice of the king. You go tell the king, let the temple be purified. But in order that it be purified, all of the pagan gods will be taken and thrown away. The bodies of the saints brought in, and let this be a temple with only the true God in it. So he sent the request to the pagan temple, to pagan emperor. And the pagan emperor said, all right, no problem, throw the gods out. And they threw the gods out. And he put an altar in the temple. It must have been the Pantheon. Put an altar in the temple up against the wall, and they prayed, and some few souls went in. And they brought the saints, but there was great devotion. And then he saw another pope. And another pope sometime in the future. Then I witnessed the vision, and then this. And in this time, I witnessed a vision in the smallest detail. So another pope has a church as well, and he erects false temples. I had witnessed this vision even in the smallest detail. I saw again the present pope in the dark church of his time in Rome. It seemed to be a large old house, like a town hall with columns in front. I saw no altar in it, but only benches, and in the middle of it, something like a pulpit. They had preaching and singing, but nothing else. And only very few attended it. And lo, a most singular sight. Each member of the congregation drew an idol from his breast and set it up before him and prayed to it. It was as if each man drew forth his secret thoughts or passions under the appearance of a dark cloud, which once outside took some definite form. They were precisely such figures as I had seen around the neck of the illicit bride in the nuptial house. Figures of men and angels. The god of one was short and broad, with a crisp head and numerous outstretched arms ready to seize and devour all in its reach. That of another was quite small, with miserable, shrunken limbs. Another had merely a block of wood, upon which he gazed with rolling eyes. This one had a horrible animal, and that one a long pole. The most singular part of it was that the idols filled the place. The church, although the worshipers were so few, was so crowded with idols. When the service was over, everyone's god re-entered his breast. The whole church was draped in black, and all that took place in it was shrouded in gloom. Then I saw the connection between the two popes and the two temples. I am sorry that I have forgotten the numbers, but I was shown how weak the one had been in the inheritance and adherence and human support, but how strong and courage to overturn so many gods and to unite so many different forms of worship into one. And on the contrary, how strong in numbers and yet how irresolute in action was the other, since in authorizing the erection of false temples, he had allowed the only true God, the only true religion, to be lost among so many false gods and false religions. It was also shown to me that those pagans humbly adored gods other than themselves, and that they would have been willing to admit in all simplicity the only God, the Most Holy Trinity. Their worship, the worship of the pagans, was preferable to that of those who adore themselves and 1,000 idols to the total exclusion of our Lord. We see here, what is the false worship? We speak of the abomination of desolation in the holy place. What is the abomination of desolation in the holy place? It's in the book of Daniel the prophet. He speaks about it. We have this experience of that abomination of desolation in the time of the Maccabees. And Judas comes into the temple. And it's interesting, when Judas finally gets to the temple, after fighting for about 3 years, originally, the Jews turned away from God, and they went to sports. They went to gymnasiums, and they ran around naked, and they worshiped sports. And they had a great time. Then they turned to the pagan gods, and they were told to worship them, and so they did. But what happened by the time that Judas got to the temple? The altar had been profanated, and the priests offered a false sacrifice. But by the time Judas got to the temple, we read in the book of Maccabees, the temple was desolate and empty. The altar had been profanated by a false worship, the abomination of desolation in the holy place. That is, the false worship of a false god by the true priest inside of the true temple. It was in the real temple of Jerusalem. The altar was still intact. But when he looked around the place of the temple, it was grown up in trees, and there were shrubs, and it was all completely desolate. There was trees in the temple, there was rocks turned up on top of each other, because they were no longer worshiping like they when they first went and made the false worship, everybody came. But by the time that Judas came, the temple was empty, and it was desolate. And why is that? Why is that? Because when we go to worship false gods, when we go to a false worship, the first thing we do, we say we're like the pagans. But we're nothing like the pagans, as Stan Kaffenberg points out in her vision. The pagans were humble, and we are proud. The pagans recognized a god outside of themselves. We see this very much in India. In India, when speaking to the Hindus, it is so clear that they are superior to every Western man. It's so obvious. They know that the gods are not themselves. They know that food is given to them because of the gods. They know that if they get wealthy, it's because of a blessing of the gods. They do not see the great power of themselves, but they know the power comes from the outside. And they know they need blessings from the outside. And they don't need help from the outside. They know they need an outside God to help them. In fact, as it says, the man Carpenter points out, these pagans would gladly and quickly convert. In the 1950s, the 1940s in India, the missionaries reported that the Hindus are ready to make a mass conversion. They're ready to enter the church. We foresee in the very near future hundreds of thousands, or lakhs and crores, the way they would say over there, lakhs and lakhs of conversions, and crores of conversions, millions and hundreds of thousands of conversions. We see it about ready to happen, and they are beginning to come to the church. But then came Vatican II. Vatican II destroyed India, and it destroyed the West. But what did it do? It brought in the worship of which Anne Catherine Abbott saw. This is the greatest of all the abominations of desolations. Whenever you go into a normal pagan worship, the guy, at least the priest, maybe he's got a little fat belly, maybe he's, you know, he likes gods with swords, maybe he likes goddesses better than he likes gods, maybe he likes trees. But the god decides, you're going to worship this tree. The priest decides, you worship this tree, you worship that goddess, you worship this god. Otherwise, get out of my temple. Those days are over. Those days are over. Now what happens? See this false worship. Go back to the vision of Anne Catherine Emmerich. And the same thing happened to the Jews. They all turned away from God. They went to the false worship. You know what happened? False worship was at 10 o'clock in the morning, and I gotta go fishing. The false worship was 10 o'clock in the morning, I don't get up till noon. The false worship was at 10 o'clock in the morning, you know what? I gotta watch the NFL pregame show, man. My game comes on at 4 o'clock. I gotta know whether the same 11 guys are gonna be on the team at 4 o'clock, they're gonna be there at 10. I gotta watch the pregame show. And don't forget about fantasy football. Now, I would go to the false worship, but I mean, tired, man. These are the Jews. The temple was packed with all the pagan worship. The temple was packed with all them worshiping the false gods, and they profanated the temple. And they destroyed it. But then what happened? See the Pope of the old days? He told the emperor, we are going to remove the statues. So many of the pagans that would have come to the ceremony didn't come because they were offended that their pagan gods were removed, and less people came. But in fact, there'll be less at both worships. And he says, and so there was, look at all these gods. These are the gods of our people today. Look at the gods that Anne Catherine Emmerich saw in her dream. I saw this people come and take numbers of statues. That was the old one. Many of them were enclosed. Figures that I had seen around the neck of the illicit bride in the nuptial house. Figures of men and animals. Here were the gods. So remember, they went to the church. He saw the people go to the church, and they were in the church, and the false priest was in the front of the church, and there was time to pray. But there was no altar. There was only a pulpit, and there was only singing, and there was some kind of a making noise. That was it. And then it came time to pray. And each person reached into their breasts and pulled out their own idol. You have BYOB. Bring your own beer. But now when you go to church, it's BYOI. Bring your own idol. BYOG. Bring your own God. So they brought their own God. And consider these gods. The God of one was short and broad, with a crisp head and numerous outstretched arms, ready to seize and devour all in its reach. That's a pretty cool god. The god of another was quite small, with miserable shrunken limbs. That's not a very cool god. The god of another one was merely a block of wood. We're going downhill here. The god of another one was a block of wood upon which he gazed with rolling eyes. These are some downright worshipful people. This one had a horrible animal, and that one a long pole. And each person in the church had so many different kinds of idols. You know what I worship? My lucky toothpick. My lucky toothpick. my lucky terrible towel, my lucky sock. That's what we worship. The most singular part of it was that the idols filled the place. The church, although the worshipers were so few, was so crowded with idols. When the service was over, everyone's God re-entered his breast. So this is my God. You don't touch my God. You don't mess with my God. My God goes with me. I bring my God to this church. I bring my God to that church. What is ecumenism? Why is ecumenism so popular today? And why is ecumenism so easy today? And why is it entered into Catholic tradition? It's everywhere. Because you have your own God in your breast. You got your own God in your coat pocket. You don't wear a coat anymore. You got it in a little bitty pocket where you put your cigarettes. And besides, it'll take up much space. You don't need to have a big spot for your God. Right now, he fits on your cell phone. You can download the app. And so the fact is, you've got your own God. Everybody's got their own God. And he can travel with you wherever you go. And hence, it doesn't matter what church you go to. You can go to the conservative Protestant church. You can go to the liberal Protestant church. You can go to the conservative Catholic church. You can go to the liberal Catholic church. You can go to church every Easter and Ash Wednesday and Christmas without fail. Or you can go once or twice in a lifetime. Or if you want, you can go every day except Sundays. Like one of the priests told me, and several priests told me in El Sordo, how many of their faithful, the old ladies, they go to Mass every day except Sunday. That's when they take a break. So they go on Monday, they go on Tuesday, they go on Wednesday, they go on Thursday, they go on Friday, they go on Saturday morning, they go again on Saturday night, Sunday, they rest. It's a day of rest, right? Every day except Sunday. Everyone has their own God. Now, how does this create a problem for us? The abomination of desolation can travel anywhere. Because the new God is in the heart. The new God I carry with me. And that is why we are more vile a people, more disgusting a people than any pagans. We find ourselves revolted by the Aztecs. We find ourselves revolted by the Incas and by the ancient pagan gods. When they used to say, you need to give me all your babies and we will sacrifice them or else you will die. We must sacrifice your babies to the gods. Bring your soldiers here, bring your young men here, we'll cut out their hearts and eat them or else the gods will be angry. Those priests who cut out the hearts and those people who believed in that bloody worship in Mexico, for instance, the last time a heart was cut out on one of those temples was 500 years ago. There's been a lot of rain since then, a lot of storms. The blood is still in the stone. The blood has not come out. So much blood. We're horrified. We're horrified. What are we horrified at? They at least knew that God was a God of justice. They at least knew that their grace and their strength came from God. They at least knew they depended upon God. They at least knew that they were not God. And then St. Catherine exceeds in this wicked time. Coming from a wicked pope. Men will go to the Catholic Church in order to worship themselves. Now, as they worship themselves more and more, you can see then how it's not such a great a danger. You see how the Latin Mass is growing in the church? There's more Latin Masses than there were before. Isn't that wonderful? There are more conservative priests than there were before. More priests celebrating the Latin Mass. More priests wearing their cassocks. Isn't that great? In fact, it's an abomination. Why is it? Because it is not a threat to the devil. Because what has happened? Man worships himself. He feels empty. He wants to find some way to cover his emptiness. And he can't find it anymore in that new church. He's sick of the bad music. You know, they play this bad music. Gregorian chant is like so much better. And so you go to the Catholic church where there's Gregorian chant. Makes you feel better. And you go to the place that says what you want to hear. And what's happening? The prophecy of St. Paul is still being fulfilled. He said in the end of times, there will be wicked teachers and wicked men. And these wicked teachers will tell the people what they want to hear. And the wicked men shall have itching ears, and they shall heap up themselves wicked teachers, St. Paul says to St. Timothy. And so you go to the priest, it's balanced. Father, don't tell me to have one baby after another. That doesn't fit my block of wood that I worship. Aaron, and it's not big enough for four babies. You want me to have 10? Forget it. How am I going to fit that in my pocket? How am I going to carry that around? And the fact is, everyone worships their own way. They worship their own thinking. And you go to a modern church that has 20 people in it, and Anglican says, but the church was full. It's packed with idols to the exclusion of our Lord. And then the Lord showed her the pagans. Look at these pagans worshiping a tree. Look at these pagans worshiping an idol. Look at these pagans following a wicked priest who's obviously evil. They are more humble. They are more supernatural. They are more spiritual. They are better in every way than these modern souls. The devil is not threatened anymore by the Latin Mass. He's not threatened anymore. You know, if you wear the beretta, that means you're really a good guy. He's not threatened by the beretta anymore. He's not threatened by the vestments anymore. A few years ago, we couldn't get these vestments. This is new from India. Now we can get them easily. We couldn't get them before. The vestments are available. The Latin Mass is available. The singing is available. But what's the problem? Everyone got used to worshiping themselves. They got used to carrying the idol inside their breasts. And they went to the false church and they carried their idol. And that's what you're supposed to do in a false church. It's a place of idols. It's a place of devils. Now you come to the true Mass. Bring your idol. This is the abomination of desolation in the holy place. You actually worship yourself, worship your own pleasure, worship your own greed. Where everyone worships themselves and they make themselves a god. Notice also that Anne Catherine noticed in her vision, some of the gods weren't very imaginative. Some of the gods weren't very impressive. Like, why would you have a god with wimpy arms? You know, I would punch you, but my god doesn't have, you know, he can't punch. It's your god. Redraw him. Refresh the screen. Get a different app. But the fact is that people are become so weak, so empty, they don't even know what to desire. Now, this is another effect of Satan's work inside of our world. Because we were told by our fathers in the generation of World War II, the baby boomers, we were told by the Generation X and the generation that came before that, the so-called greatest generation, that the purpose of life is money. And the purpose of life is to get a solid house for yourself, make a solid place for your kids, build your own little castle, and be happy. And it's a complete lie. So now the younger generation knows that it's a complete lie. They try their own house, they try their own the wealth of the world and its emptiness. So therefore, their gods are not as strong as the old gods. The old gods used to beat up the other gods. The old gods used to protect your own stuff. But the new gods are weaker. And in the vision of Anne Catherine, she's seeing these new gods. They still have gods. They still have idols. But the idols don't have the ambitions of the old idols. They don't have the strength of the old idols. It may just be a block of wood, or a pole, or a toothpick, or a terrible towel. What is their god? And they feel empty. So they blame the emptiness not on their god, not on their selfishness, not on their wickedness, but on that false church you're going to. So they jump from church to church. And since it doesn't matter what idols the priest worships. In the old days, you had to check on the front of the church. It says, we worship Buddha. Okay, that's the Buddha church. But now it doesn't matter what it says on the front. That's just what the priest worships. We can worship whatever we want when we go to that church. And hence, ecumenism. Ecumenism is a wickedness that's only possible in an age of total tepidity and mediocrity. When we go back to the vision of St. Francis. Why is the world so ugly today? Why is it that there is complete immorality everywhere? Because each person cares only about their own God. Now notice that St. Francis, who is the one that loves birds and he likes all the animals, he's not very dogmatic, he's a nice saint. What does St. Francis say in his vision about these wicked times? They will endeavor to draw many into error and death. Scandals will be multiplied. That's immoral stuff. Our order will be divided, and many others will be entirely destroyed because. So we're going to have homosexual priests. We're going to have priests running out with women. We're going to have priests devoted to thieving and stealing. We're going to have priests that are liars and cheats in every other way. We're going to have all manner of scandal amongst the Catholic people. Why? Because they will consent to error instead of opposing it. That's St. Francis. Why is there going to be pedophilia? Why is there going to be abortion? Why are there going to be broken marriages? Why are they going to talk about giving communion to the divorce and the remarried? Because they will consent to error instead of opposing it. Error is the cause. There will be such diversity of opinions and schisms amongst the people, the religious and the clergy, that except those days, amongst the people, religious and clergy, that except those days were shortened according to the words of the gospel, even the elect would be led into error. Were they not specially guided amid such confusion by the immense mercy of God? What is the only thing that's going to preserve us from error? The only thing that's going to preserve us from going down the wicked ways of the modern world, the immense mercy of God. There's nothing else. We must recognize that if God has blessed us with our Holy Roman Catholic faith, we are able to try to hold this faith and do hold this faith, as Archbishop Lefebvre did, and as the saints did down the last 2,000 years. Why is it? Because of the immense mercy of God. Let me go quickly to the last passage of St. Francis. Why do we have a bad pope? Does he come from the devil? Not according to St. Francis. St. Francis says, the sanctity of life will be held in derision even by those who outwardly profess it. For in those days, our Lord Jesus Christ will send them not a true pastor, but a destroyer. Who sends the destroyer? Our Lord does. Not the devil. And why does he send the destroyer? Why does he send the wicked pastor? Like Father Hannifin, he used to stand in this pulpit many years. He used to say, remember, you get the priest that you deserve. We have wicked priests all over the church today. We have wicked priests all in the highest place of the hierarchy, in the Holy Rome, Holy in Rome. We have wicked bishops. Were they sent by Satan? St. Francis said 800 years ago, in those wicked days, our Lord Jesus Christ will send them not a true pastor who loves their souls, but a destroyer. A destroyer. Look at the history of the Old Testament. Whenever the Jews turned away from God, the mention of the retreat, it was a good day to be a Philistine. You're going to whack the Jews. But if the Jews repented, it's a bad day to be a Philistine. Philistines win when Jews are bad. Philistines lose when Jews are good. And it's the same thing in the New Testament. When the Catholics are horrible and evil, it's a good day to be a communist. But if the Catholics convert and repent, it's a bad day to be a communist. The day of repentance. What's going to happen? When the Pope finally obeys the Heavenly Mother, consecrates Russia to the Immaculate Mary in union with all the bishops, there will be a conversion of Catholics. There will be a conversion of souls back to God. And then the enemies of God shall be destroyed. They shall be smashed. All over the Psalms, they're going to be smashed. They're going to be destroyed. But what is our problem right now? We know the abomination of desolation is in the holy place. That is, the false mass. There will be another abomination of desolation at the very end of times when the Antichrist. But this is an abomination of desolation, the new mass. False church, leading souls away from God. But what's the problem with this idolatry? Witnessed by Anne Catherine Emmerich? It's idols brought to church by themselves. So what happens when you leave the novice order of church? And you leave liberalism, and you come to the truth of tradition. Don't forget to bring your idol from home. Bring the idol. And you know what? The priests respond to that because we're seeing the priests having itching ears. We noticed, for instance, in the last 20 years, in the realm of morality, more and more traditional priests, or so-called traditional priests, priests of the Society of Pius X, and so-called conservative priests, have been saying to mothers, you can leave your husband, you can not, don't worry about having those extra children. You don't have to follow every detail of the gospel. We don't need to be too judgmental against the indulge. We don't need to be too judgmental against the sin of Icondus. We don't need to be too judgmental against any particular error or heresy. We got to be balanced. You don't need to worry too much about those dresses, young ladies. Be balanced. Some of our priests now tell the girls, make sure you wear your jeans, wear your pants, whenever you're outside the church, whenever you're going into town. You don't need to be too extreme. Why are they saying that? Because they understand what the people want. See, when you stand in the pulpit, you're supposed to be a tough guy. I'm in charge. But when you see all these eyes, good idea, I won't. And then don't forget about the fact you got your boss behind you. And the boss is dumping on you from above, and the children are dumping on below, and so the priest says meaningful words that have no meaning, but make you feel really good. Holy, nice. And we're Catholic, so you can always say your rosary. It's a safe one. Say your rosary. You'd better say your rosary or pray your rosary. But is that all? Does the rosary have any demands with it? Does it have any commands that it requires? Beware of the fact there are many idols that enter into our churches. Many idols come into our pews. They hide them in the breast. Remember the Jews, when they left Israel, they gave them all kinds of gold. Moses said, don't bring the idols. But some idols are nice and small. I'm not going to bring it. It's not an idol. It's just gold. I'm going to melt it. But, just keep it. And so they brought the idols into Egypt. And the scripture of the fathers tell us, not only did they bring the idols that were gold in Egypt, from Egypt, they brought the idols of the heart from Egypt. They brought Satanism from Egypt. And even though they were killed by God, the Satanism remained. So much so that the Jesuits tell us and the fathers of the church tell us, all Satanism that's in the world today comes from Egypt. And it stayed in Israel. Solomon reached back into it when he was older. When he was younger, he had the wisdom of God. When he was older, he took on the wisdom of Satanism. He took on the wisdom of Egypt. Therefore, was punished by God. Beware of these idols. Oh, I'm not going to the new mass, so I'm okay. It's all about the mass, is it? Is it? There are many Japanese in heaven right now. Lived during those 200 years between 1640 and 1840, plus or minus, never went to one mass, never saw a single priest. They are now seeing God face to face. Why? Because they had the faith and they loved the faith and they would not give up that faith. And they were in a land in which you would be killed for having the faith, which is a negative in many lands that way, but there was no priests. And there will be many punished. I will bet you there are many souls in hell right now of priests, of bishops, and perhaps also popes between 1660, 1640, and 1840. Why didn't they send missionaries back to Japan? Why did they wait 200 years? That was the good old days. When the missionaries went into Germany, before St. Boniface, they set up an altar, they set up a church, and they were killed. They murdered all of them in Frisia, killed every single monk. The word came back to France, the monks are dead. Another 50 monks rebuilt the monastery. They killed all the monks. Another 70 monks came to rebuild the monastery. They killed all the monks. Another 100 monks came, rebuilt the monastery. And they came and said, aren't you guys dead? What the heck are you doing? Well, we're rebuilding the monastery. And they converted. They didn't wait. They didn't wait. What happened to our church in the last 500 years? In fact, what has happened is that this idol, which is an idol in the Catholic Church, because in the vision of Anne Catherine Emmerich, she's in the 1800s, in the vision of Anne Catherine Emmerich, she sees the pagans. They worship false idols. It's the Catholics. These are the ones who put the idol in their breasts. So they're going to worship their lucky toothpick. They're going to worship their terrible towel. They're going to worship a block with their eyes rolling upon it. They're going to worship beer. They're going to worship whiskey. They're going to worship Mad Dog 2020, which is crap. So my first was her favorite. Think, please drink this crap. But nonetheless, what are they worshiping? The gods are pathetic. The modern gods are pathetic. Notice also in India, visiting the gods, seeing all the statues, very often you see some gods that they're just growing up in weeds, you know. That, I mean, they worship the god and everything, but they're not going to pull weeds. And they worship the god and everything, but they don't like go over there and pray to them. And what they'll do sometimes, in order to save the time of having to pray, they'll take a tape, like a child's music tape from America, they'll put it into a player and play it. And it'll be singing, you know, what do you call it, Yankee Doodle Dandy, and that's to their god. They don't care, it's like music, it's to the gods. Happy Birthday and other songs they play to the gods, because it's your peace getting out of bed and going and worshiping your god. Some of them actually go to the trouble of being a little more ornate. Our gods are worse. And we have to recognize that we're in a time in which the gods have entered the breasts, and we bring the gods into the church. We brought the gods into the church, they pulled them out of the breast, and they worshiped them, and the church was filled with idols. And then the church service was over, and they put the idols back in their breasts and went back outside. And all was covered in a shroud of gloom. That's our age. Everybody's taking medication. Everybody's depressed. If we're truly followers of Christ and having the truth, why are we depressed? Why is the traditional Catholics got to take medication just like everybody else? Why is that? Because we still have the gods of the modern world in our breasts. That's the problem. These gods have to be eradicated. And we haven't solved the problem because we haven't gone to the new mass lately. We haven't solved the problem because we haven't worshipped any false gods lately. We haven't solved the problem because we hold the truth in our doctrine only. We don't really hold it. Because St. Francis says, they did not stand against error. And notice also the words of St. Francis. What causes the immorality growing in the society of St. Pius X? What's the cause of the immorality growing throughout the whole world? St. Francis says, well, the good ones first. They shall fall, those who do not stand for the truth shall fall into tepidity, where they will not be able to support the temptations permitted for the proven of the elect. We're going to have temptations. We'll fall because of a small of timidity. Those who persevere, those who preserve their fervor and adhere to virtue with love and zeal for the truth. That's all St. Francis talks about, the truth. Who love and zeal for the truth, they will suffer injuries and persecutions, and they as rebels and schismatics. For their persecutors, urged on by the evil spirits, will say they are rendering a great service to God by destroying such pestilent men from the face of the earth. But the Lord will be the refuge of the afflicted and will save all who trust in Him. We can't take it anymore. We can't go on. The Lord will save all who trust in Him. No exceptions. And in order to be like their head, our Lord Jesus Christ, These, the elect, will act with confidence, and by their death will purchase for themselves eternal life. So says St. Francis. We must act with confidence. You know, one of the great lies of today? Well, you know, there's so many opinions. There's so many, everybody's got their own opinion. There's so many different teachings of theologians. Don't be too confident that you're holding the truth. Respect the other guy's opinion. Did St. Valentine, we quote so many times, respect the opinion of Emperor Datius? No. He blasted him. And he told Datius, you accept the true religion or you will die. Guess what happened? Within a few days or weeks, Datius died. He died. Valentine, he sent it to eternal salvation, and he himself went shortly after to eternal damnation. And all knew the prophecy of Valentine, and it came true. So they must speak with confidence, and by their death they will purchase themselves eternal life. Choosing to obey God rather than man, they will fear nothing, and they will prefer to perish rather than consent to falsehood and perfidy. Remember, in this prophecy of St. Francis, it mentions the word scandals once. Scandals includes all the impure things and all the stealing and all the sins against the seven capital sins and against the great virtues. But he says, what's the cause? Lack of faith. Not standing up against error. Not believing the truth. Why did St. Athanasius? Why did they try to kill him from the time he was a deacon? And he inserted into the creed, without doubt, all those, unless they hold the whole Catholic faith in entirety, without doubt, they shall perish. And the Arians did not hold it, and they tried to kill the deacon. And he became a bishop later, and they never ever forgave Athanasius, and never did. Because he said, without the whole Catholic faith as it's handed down to us by our Lord Jesus Christ and the 12 apostles, every single human being will be damned. Accept that faith, you'll be able to put it into practice. Accept that faith, you'll be able to leave homosexuality. Accept that faith, you'll be able to stay with your wife who's a wicked witch of the West. So Pope Francis says you can dump her if you feel obliged. With that faith, you'll be able to leave that beautiful fourth wife that you have. And you'll be able to stand for the truth. With that faith, you can do all kinds of things. Without that faith, you can do nothing. And hence, St. Francis says, opposing the truth, opposing the error, standing for the truth, all is all that matters. They will prefer to perish rather than consent to falsehood and purity. Some preachers will keep silence about the truth. Some preachers will keep silence about the truth. This will lead to the damnation of souls. Others will trample it underfoot and deny it. Look at our situation in the Society of St. Pius X right now, and in the church in general. Be silent about the truth, you may survive. The other option is spit on it, trample on it, curse it, and you will do well. But if you speak the truth clearly and plainly and condemn the errors clearly and plainly, it's requiem aeternam. It's excommunication and persecution. It's being called a rebel and a schismatic. But this is what we have to do. And then, of course, because our Lord Jesus Christ will send a destroyer. How do we get our Lord Jesus Christ to change his mind? Send us a good pope. How did the Lord Jesus Christ send his mind and get the church, get back on its feet? We have to truly repent in our hearts and remove the idol of the modern world from our hearts. There are so many idols, so many idols. Many times in my own priesthood, I cannot count the number of times in which Catholic fathers have told their children and Catholic mothers have told their children, you need to make sure when you grow up, you get a good job. You need to make sure that you can support a family. Make sure you can take care of your own. Be hardworking and responsible. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the pagans do this. can't go to heaven if that's what you do. That's what the gospel says. We are obliged to do more. And unless we do more, it's eternal damnation. Not only that, you don't have to be able to support your family. The greatest beggars in the world are called saints. Remember St. Francis Xavier Cabrini? She wasn't responsible. She built an orphanage house on top of a mountain outside of Denver, Colorado. And they sent her, the construction workers sent her a bill. So you got to pay for this. She said, Deo gratias, and sent the bill back. And they were pretty ticked off. And every one of them wanted to quit. They said, you're not responsible, you're supposed to pay us. She said, Deo gratias, now get to work. And they built the whole thing. And they built it on top of the mountain. And then the head construction guy and all the workers stood behind him. Says, you know, Denver's at the bottom of the mountain. We're at the top of the mountain. You can't bring your kids here. Said, why not? Because there's no water. You have to drink. You didn't think of that, did you? You didn't check with the city planning commission. You didn't check on the code. She had a staff in her hands. She said, you want water? Here it is. She took the staff and she hit a rock, and water came out of the rock. It's still coming out this day, 100 years later. The water came out of the rock, and now all of a sudden there are farmers on the mountain, and their cows are drinking that water. Do we have faith or not? What are we here for? Why are we on this earth? What are we fighting? We're fighting error and perfidy. That's what St. Francis, the guy that loved birds, said. That's what he said. What's the cause of immorality? A lack of faith. Now, when we don't have that, when we don't let the faith be our principal fight, then why are we really fighting? It might be that you like gods with swords, and you don't like gods that are fruitcakes. So therefore, you fight against the fruitcake god. You've got to be a holy guy, you're against fruitcake. Or you might be a really peaceful guy, and you like gods that are about peace, love, and harmony. So you're against violence. You're a great God. All it is that we have our own gods that we choose, and we fight against the other gods that make our God uncomfortable. And how, which of these gods is pleasing to the true God? Which of these gods is worse than the other gods? Which of these gods is better than the other gods? All of them are pulled out of our breasts. All of them are brought to church. And you're going to see the image of Bancroft and Emmerich. They went to church. They knelt down with devotion. They reached into their pockets and they pulled out their God. Now it's called the cell phone. And they worshiped. They worshiped. We have to fight this kind of worship. And pray for our Lord to send us a true pastor to replace the wicked shepherds. This cannot happen if we don't truly convert in our hearts and have true faith and true confidence. It's the only way. So pray for that amongst young men entering the brotherhood in the seminary and others that are striving to come. The devil's always trying to cause damage. There were the 15 or so that are here right now, 14 or 15, whatever it is, and the couple that are trying to come. They're here to give their life to God. Pray that there be a conversion of the soul, and that there be a fight against error, and they not come here with their gods. It's so easy to hide them. So easy to hide them. And we're going just to fight for the kingdom of Christ. We have to fight against these modern idolatry, and we have to stand for the holy truth. And remember when Judas Maccabeus walked into that temple, what did he do? They saw the true altar. And notice what it says here. They found priests without blemish. Most of the priests did the false worship. And Judas said, and he cleansed the temple. He chose priests without blemish, whose will was set upon the law of God. And they cleansed the holy places. The others can't cleanse it. Was priests without blemish to cleanse the holy place. And they took away the stones. But the altar wasn't damaged. And they had a council to tear down the altar. Why? Because it was profanated. I believe when Vatican II comes to an end, one of the first commands of the new pope is to go to the main altar of St. Peter's and obliterate it. Destroy it. Exorcise the entire church and rebuild an identical altar. One that has not had the new mass celebrated on it. One that has not had dancing girls. There are so many pictures in front of that altar. Pope Benedict with the homosexual dancers in front of him. Pope John Paul II with the naked American ladies dancing in front of him. In front of that altar. And the new mass on that altar. But the altar is the same as when it was made 500 years ago. What must be done when the church goes back to its senses? They will have a council. And they will go to that altar and they will destroy it. Rebuild an identical altar made of new stones. And it says here, what did we do with the stones? They took the stones far away. So when they tore down the altar, they picked up the stones and they took them far away to a safe place and they buried them. The stones couldn't even be used. Couldn't be used. But in any case, the time of victory of Judas Maccabeus is going to come. And then they cleanse the altar, brought back the temple to its glory. It will come again. It will come again with the church. In any case, with the close here, we're going too long, they're here all day and only have one mass, so we're going to make up for the three masses thing. So I don't like only having one mass. But in any case, and we'll have a little picnic thing after the mass, and so down inside of the garage, and all of them stay for that, and then we'll have hamburgers and whatever else, and then little activities in the afternoon, and God bless you all, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Ad crema mi portentem.
nominos vobispo.
Ergo Spiritu Sancto.
Sancti Caritas, Sancta Maria. gracias obtiene. Domine sangue patrini potens et Deus, qui cum une genito filio tuo, et spiritus sancto unus est Deus, unus est Dominus. Non in ius in qualitate persone, sed in unius venitate substantiae. Orin de tua gloria revolante te credimus, hoc te filio tuo, hoc te spiritus sancto, sine differentia discretioni sentimus. Un in confessione veris e fidelique deitati, et in personis proprietas, et in essentia unita, et in maestate arore dure qualita. Quam laudant angeli atque arcangeli, cherubim quoque archerafim, vidantes acclamare quod didie, una voce dicente.
Thank you.
I Dominos vobis cum.
Tecum spiritum tuo.
Oremus. Gratias divire venibus Domini sacrum unire peccati. Tua misericordiam deprecantes, ut dignos nos eius participatione perficias. Perdam rotum iesum visum filium tuum, qui tecum vir regnat unitate spiritus sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Dominos vobiscum.
Tecum spiritu tuo.
Amen.